In September 2009, I had the opportunity to interview Nasr Abu Zayd at the University of Leiden in the Netherlands. Professor Abu Zayd and I had corresponded for a number of years about his writings, about his teachings, about his views on the interpretations of the Quran, and about his life in exile. On that September day, a cameraman, Carrie Fry, and I sat down with Professor Abu Zayd for a number of hours to film the interview that's going to follow. This interview is part of a larger project that I have been working on for a number of years to capture on film the life and the story of writers, artists, and intellectuals from Muslim-majority states in exile. Indeed, of all the hundreds, if not thousands, of intellectuals from the Muslim-majority world who ended up in exile in the 1990s, Nasr Abu Zayd's story is, without question, one of the most important and intriguing of the decade. Professor Abu Zayd was born in a small village outside of Cairo in 1943. He received his undergraduate degree from the University of Cairo in Arabic Studies in 1972. And in 1981, he took his PhD in Islamic studies from the same university. The following year, he began to teach as a faculty member of the Department of Arabic Language and Literature at the University of Cairo. In 1987, he was promoted to the rank of associate professor at that same university. Widely regarded as one of the world's most important scholars of the Quran, Professor Abu Zayd's troubles began in 1992 when he put himself forward for promotion to full professor at the University of Cairo. He had just published The Critique of Religious Discourse. As is well known, his promotion was denied, and he speaks very openly and candidly about the events that transpired during his promotion case at the University of Cairo. As he makes clear throughout the interview, he was both horrified and shocked with the allegations that somehow he had committed an affront to the Islamic faith, a charge that was brought against him by one of his colleagues who was responsible for overseeing his promotion case at the University of Cairo. He faults very clearly in the interviews the administrators at the University of Cairo who refused to take a position against the Islamist extremists that were mounting a charge against him. In his view, it was a lack of moral leadership on the part of the administrators at the University of Cairo that led to the escalation of the conflict, as the conflict quickly transcended the boundaries of the university and moved into the Egyptian court system. Only corruption in all of its forms could have led to this escalation, and he makes clear that all throughout this conflict he never lost faith in the power of academics to somehow emerge victorious from the struggle. However unshakable his belief in academia was, there were still severe consequences for him. In 1995, after a few years of wrangling in the lower courts, the Cairo Appeals Court upheld the charges against him and, based on those grounds, divorced him forcibly from his wife, claiming that a Muslim woman could no longer be married to an apostate. His troubles augmented rapidly. The terrorist organization, the Egyptian Islamic Jihad, notorious for having assassinated Anwar Sadat, condemned Nasr Abu Zayd to death and ordered his execution. He was provided with state security and lived under constant surveillance. As he puts it, his normal life in Egypt came to an end, and he had to make the rather difficult choice of leaving Egypt. From summer 2005 until July 5, 2010, Nasr Abu Zayd lived in exile. In the meantime, his wife returned to Cairo to teach at the University of Cairo in the French department. He seldom returned to Egypt, and when he did, it was primarily to visit his family. In the summer 2005, Nasr Abu Zayd was flying from Indonesia to Cairo. He contracted a rare virus and was hospitalized in Cairo. He succumbed to this virus and died on July 5, 2010 in Cairo. The tragic timing of his death, coming only a few months before the beginning of the Arab Spring and the downfall of the Mubarak regime, convinces me even more of the importance of this interview. The interview helps us understand Nasr Abu Zayd as a scholar, as a man, and most importantly, as an Egyptian. Professor Abu Zayd asked me to ensure that when this film aired, that due credit was given to the institution that for so long had given him a place to live and supported him throughout his life in exile. He held for many years the Ibn Rushd Chair of Humanism and Islam at the University of Humanistics at Utrecht, the Netherlands. And he wanted to make sure that when this interview aired, that his institution, the University of Utrecht, would be given proper credit. As a filmmaker and a scholar, I would like to thank Nasr Abu Zayd one final time for allowing me to spend that day in September with him. My hope is that by putting this film in a format that can be seen by all, Nasr Abu Zayd will continue to inspire and transform the world. There is no question that viewers can see here the mind of one of the greatest scholars of the Quran at work, and that the people of Egypt struggling to overcome decades of tyranny and oppression can find in one of its greatest citizens a cause for hope.
Okay. So name is Nasr Abu Zayd. I'm Egyptian, born 1943. Now I'm an emeritus professor. Obviously I'm in the humanities in the University of Humanistics in Utrecht, Holland. I'm also emeritus professor in Leiden University. I have been here in the Netherlands since 1995.
Okay, so can you explain how it is that you came to be teaching at the University of Leiden? Just the basic kind of sets of circumstances of Leiden.
Well, it's the story in a very simple way. I was I'm still a professor in Cairo University. I graduated in Cairo University, got my PhD in Cairo University in Quranic studies. And I was, became an associate professor also in Quranic studies in 1987. Okay. That's very. Okay. So I mean, everything was okay. It's the story of Quranic studies in Cairo University is not really a pleasant story, because the professor whose name was Amin al-Kholi, who initiated and developed the literary approach to the Quran, and he supervised a thesis about Quranic narrative in the Quran, al-Qasas al-Qurani, for Quran al-Kareem. This thesis have created a heated debate in Egypt that reached the parliament. And at the end, the university refused the thesis. And the student who was an assistant lecturer at that time was, kicked out of the university. And his professor, Amin al-Kholi, the real pioneer in Quranic studies in modern age, was prohibited from teaching Quranic studies or supervising thesis in Quranic studies. This was 1947. Okay. Since then, Quranic study in the Department of Arabic Language and Literature in the Faculty of Arts, Cairo University, this is where I was working, became like, a hobby. Whoever would like to teach it, it is assigned to whoever would feel he would get some barakah, blessing. So it is not anymore a field of academic research. Okay, so it's it. So then I came. I graduated in 1972, and my intention from the very beginning was not really Quranic studies. Basically, because I knew all about these, these problems. Okay. Maybe for just a clarification, I did not enroll in the university education in ordinary age. Okay, I had a very long experience as a citizen. I graduated from a technical school with a diploma in electronics. I worked for 15 years as a technician. Okay, but my dream of, you know, studying at the university did not really, well, so I joined, enrolled in the university when I was about, you know, 25 years old. I have a lot of reading. So I was not just an ordinary student. I have knowledge about what is going on in the society. And I was, you know, you can say I was just a little intellectual. Okay. So I know all the stories about the problems of applying any critical approach to Islamic studies or Quranic studies. I know all the story about Amin al-Khouli and his student who became a professor afterward, but not in Cairo University. Okay. So I was, although my keen interest was in Islamic study and Quranic study, but I kept, you know, no, this is not the field I should go to. It's a very dangerous field. But because the department was aware of the necessity to have a specialist in Islamic studies and in Quranic studies, they enforced it on me to either to make my higher study, my thesis, MA and PhD on Islamic studies, or I find another job. This was, you know, I mean, very exceptional way that I'm the only, you know, assistant teacher who was enforced to do a research in a specific field according to the demand of the department. It did not happen to anyone after me or before me. So anyway, I have to comply with the demand of the department. So I was thinking how to make Islamic study in an academic sense without exposing myself to this kind of, you know, threat. The history of Egypt with this is, I think everyone will know what happened, for example, in 1926. For Taha Hussein, his book about pre-Islamic poetry, Scandal, and I think just 1 year before the book of Ali Abdul Raziq about Islam wa Usul al-Hukm. Okay, so we have, you know, events of resistance to any kind of discourse which deal with the history of Islam in a critical way. Okay. I was aware of all these problems. I didn't really want to get into these problems. So I was very careful to choose my MA thesis topic. And then I chosen to study the Mu'tazila, okay, concept of metaphor, majaz, as it was applied to the Quran. So here I'm studying something in the history of exegesis rather than getting myself in exegesis myself. And my supervisor was really a very, very wonderful teacher, Professor Abdulaziz Al-Ahwani. He's not well known. So I finished my MA thesis in 1977. I got my MA degree. Excellent. And but, you know, doing research on rational theology, which is Mu'tazila, and how rational theologians tried to solve certain tensions in the Quran concerning the image of God, transcendent, immanent, anthropomorphism, issues like predestination, free will. In the Quran, there is tension between. Yeah, there are passages, for example, that could convey predestination. Other passages that could, you know, convey free will. There are passages in the Quran that present God in an anthropomorphic images, with hand, eyes, legs, head. And there are images, there are another passages in the Quran that present God the divine as absolutely transcendental. Nothing resembles him. He resembles nothing. So the Mu'tazila efforts, and here the function of metaphor, the Mu'tazila efforts was to solve, you know, this tension according to their transcendental concept of the divine and their belief in the human free will. Okay. Anyway, this research have, to a great extent, brought a lot of questions rather than answers. Okay. Because the Mu'tazilites successfully, okay, according to their, you know, to their philosophy or theology, successfully built their theory of hermeneutics on this dichotomy of clear, ambiguous, muhkam and mutashabih. Okay, there is a verse in the Quran in chapter 3, verse number 7. That speak about in the Quran there are clear verses, muhkamat, and there are ambiguous verses, mutashabihat, and people who have very good feeling in their heart would follow the mutashabih, okay, etc., to cause you know, problems, something like that. But the meaning of the mutashabih is only known by God. The Mu'tazilites have built their hermeneutic theory about this, you know. Duality of ambiguity and clarity. So all the Quranic passages that agree with their own theological conviction became designated as clear. The passages that seem to contradict this conviction had been designated as ambiguous. Metaphor was a linguistic tool to disambiguate the ambiguous, according to the Mu'tazila. Okay. At the end, this has, you know, established what we call the theological, or what I call the theological Islamic hermeneutics. All theologians, I took it for granted that the Quran could have ambiguous and clear verses. And the ambiguous should be disambiguated or explained or interpreted in the light of the clear. Mm-hmm. Okay, that's all theological schools agreed on that. Mm-hmm. But what has been considered as clear from the Mu'tazila point of view was considered ambiguous from their opponents. So the game was your clear is my ambiguous, and your ambiguous is my clear. So we have to apply metaphorical explanation in different passages. Okay, this was the conclusion, that the Quran have been a field of theological dispute and theological debate, that the Quran has been, you know, taken into this direction or that direction according to the preconceived theological idea. Theology, at the end of my analysis, is not something, you know, that is, you know, that is superstructure disconnected from the cultural, social structure of the society, the debate about politics. So I connected this theological debate into what was going on in the ground since the fitna. I mean, the civil wars that happened in with the fourth caliph Ali, with Muawiyah, etc. So this was my approach, that, you know, theology is not an activity that is disconnected from reality. In fact, all the answers presented in theological terms are meant to be answers to political issues on the ground. So now I understood, this is my conclusion. I mean, theologians have been fighting each other, not only about the meaning of the Quran, but about the structure of the Quran. Because if you see, this is not muhkam, this is not clear, this is ambiguous, this is a debate about the structure. Okay, which leads to a debate about. So from my first thesis, you can say that I came out with more complicated question than the question I started with. Okay. And these questions have, you know, directed me to my PhD thesis. I said, okay, this is theology. okay, which is very much connected to the social, social political issues. What about mysticism, which is supposed to be something of a spiritual, ethical dimension? And here my PhD thesis was about the hermeneutics of the Quran by Ibn Arabi. Ibn Arabi, an Andalusian mystic philosopher who lived in the 7th century, which is the 14th century in Andalus, and then he came to the East. This was my PhD thesis. This PhD thesis, well, after, at the end, Ibn Arabi is like an ocean, because if you just get into, it's sometimes very difficult to get out, to breathe out. So it took me 5 years, but at the end, I was able to reconstruct Ibn Arabi thought, and I found it's very, very utopia Ibn Arabi is presenting. A utopia that I found its impetus in the society of Andalus, where multilinguistic society, multi-religious society, people have to live with each other, and in the context of Reconquista in Andalus, and the same context of crusade in the East, Ibn Arabi lived this very complicated experience. Mm-hmm. He left Spain because it was under, you know, going back to be taken back by the Christian king, the Catholic kings. Mm-hmm. And when he came to the East, it was not really, you know, a better situation. Mm-hmm. Okay. So this kind of conflicting reality have, you know, inspired Ibn Arabi of creating, you know, a system, an Islamic worldview, which could reconcile all religions of the world, the religion of love. So the elements, the pantheistic philosophy of Ibn Arabi, this was my conclusion, it's not really also disconnected from this reality. Okay, this is... Now the conclusion is any attempt of interpretation of the Quran, hermeneutics of the Quran, it's an attempt that should be understood and explained according to its context. There is no, and of course here I went to the United States for 2 years. I started to read about hermeneutics, modern hermeneutics, Gadamer, the German philosopher, and you know, Pulricker, the French philosophers, and of course, all this through English translation.
Sure. Yeah.
And the first lesson you learn from hermeneutics is there is no innocent interpretation. Mm. Okay, interpretation is the outcome of this confrontation between the interpreter and the text. Okay, the text has a world, the interpreter is coming from a world. I mean, this concept of, you know, horizons. This helped me a lot in understanding Ibn Arabi. Okay. Of course, I would say now that when I started to read hermeneutics, I was loaded by my questions coming from Ibn Arabi and the Mu'tazila. And okay. So my reading in hermeneutics was not really, a receptive reading. Okay. It was, you know, a dialogue reading. So I learned a lot. I have this my debt to hermeneutics that clarified the questions that is coming out of Islamic tradition. Mm-hmm.
So just ask you a question. When you're going through hermeneutical theory, you're reading Paul Ricoeur and Gadamer. Those are the two principal.
Oh yes, yeah. With other names, of course. With other names.
I did an interview with Paul Ricoeur.
You did.
Some time ago.
I met him
sometime.
Yeah.
That's good.
Yeah.
Okay, so you were influenced by hermeneutics, and then at that point you realized you had a standpoint.
Right, okay.
And you had your own position that was...
Yeah, so my conclusion from my research on the Mu'tazila hermeneutics and Ibn Arabi hermeneutics, our conclusion was this, okay, this is exegesis. I mean, exegesis is not neutral. It could not be neutral. There's nothing like neutral. Mm-hmm. I should add to this, this is my academic, part. Sure. But there is a part of an Egyptian citizen. Mm-hmm. Okay? And I'm sure you agree with me. I mean, we are not, divided persons. I mean, the same citizen who is the same academician. Mm-hmm. Okay? Reality sometimes provides us with the questions. Right. And we go to our academic research to find solution to this question. But the question is not coming from purely academic sphere. I mean, we are human beings. We are living, we have our position, we have our conviction. We have to test our convictions all the time. The Egyptian society and the Arabic society and the entire Islamic society has been living in this dichotomy between modernity and tradition for a long time. Okay. In Egypt, in the late 60s and the beginning of the 70s, this kind of dispute and debate, which was peaceful. But some people suffered, like the people I mentioned, Taha Hussein, Ali Abdul Razak, etc., etc. But it became in the 70s very, very severe. Islamism became a phenomenon in the 70s. And the cry for the immediate application of Sharia, blah, blah, blah. This was very obvious in the 70s that led to the assassination of Sadat, president of Egypt in the 80s. So all this debate in Egypt about the meaning of Islam was also on my mind. I was grown up in a village. Okay, I was born 1943. In which I lived Islam as a very, very open, liberal religion. In my village, Christians and Copts and Muslims, we never have any problem. Okay, in my village, and this may be surprising, okay, there were some homosexuals, well known by the society. Okay, but there was no, assault to them in the name of religion. Or what you know that your mother or your father whisper in your ear, don't get association with this guy. They don't tell you why, but a child in the village would know everything. But there was no such, demand of religion to execute such persons. It did not happen. So this is the kind of religion that I learned. Religion of respect, of tolerance. People in the village at that time, very, very religious. Okay, but in the meantime, they don't really, make any, well, maybe you can make some jokes. Some people used to go to the mosque, not to pray, but to wash. Because in the mosque, in a village, there is a running water. There is no running water at houses at that time. So people would find, going to the mosque to wash and maybe to get a nap, without praying. And I was a child, knew those people, and of course, other people could make jokes about those people. Why don't you just, make two rak'ahs? Okay. But there was no such thing like you are a kafir, nothing like that. Okay. So this is the atmosphere I was brought up as a child, and I grew up in this. And of course, in the 50s and the 60s, Egypt, as you know. This was the dream of Egypt after 1952 revolution. Mm-hmm. The dream of building a new Egypt, of getting off with the British occupation, mm-hmm. having a society of social justice and equality, creating equal opportunities of education. And this is how I got educated. Mm-hmm. Okay, so these are the values that really that make me what I am. And I still believe in these values. Okay. Things changed in the 70s. So the entire meaning of Islam have, you know, turned it down 180 degrees. So this is the experience of the citizen, and this is the experience of the student. Okay, something what is going on earth, it's very much similar to what was going on in the early centuries. Mm-hmm. The struggle about the meaning of the Quran. So this was the question of my third book. Mm-hmm. Okay, so how can we get out of this kind of trying to take the meaning of the text the right direction? I mean right here in the political sense, or in the left direction. Does the Quran teach us, you know, capitalism, socialism, equality? Okay, what? So every meaning is possible. Okay, according to the modern Islamic discourse and the classical Islamic discourse, every meaning is possible. So this was my question, what is the text? Shouldn't we identify what kind of a text we have, the Quran, what kind of a text we have, before we go into applying any method of interpretation? Okay. The method should be derived from a good definition of the text. So this was my third book, The Concept of the Text. I have done this research on rereading, what in the light of my modern knowledge, rereading the classical Quranic sciences, which is called Ulum al-Quran. Okay. The conclusion in this book was not really surprising me, but it was like, you know, shocking for the society. Ulum al-Quran. Okay, as they are introduced in Suyuti, Al-Itqam fi Ulum al-Qur'an, in Al-Zarkashi, Al-Burhan fi Ulum al-Qur'an, could be generally classified in three categories. These ulum which deals with the history of the Qur'an, these ulums which deals with the structure of the Qur'an, and this ulum which deals with the excellence of the Quran. Okay. To study this ulum concerning, you know, you study the asbab al-nuzul, occasions of revelation, the differentiation between what was revealed in Mecca and what was revealed in Medina. You study the theory of nasr, abrogation. You study all the theory that is connected to how to deduce the meaning according to the linguistic structure of the Quran. What is the relationship between the passage that designate a very, very general meaning and passages that designate a very, very particular meaning, al-am and al-khas, etc., etc.? So studying this part of Quranic sciences, the part that deals with the history of the Quran, would easily make you reach the conclusion that the Quran is a historical context, that it belongs linguistically and in the domain of meaning to the 7th century, because it was addressed to the Arabs in the 7th century. Not only to the Arabs, whether the Arabs are paganist Arabs, Mecca, or the Jewish Arabs, Medina, or the Christian Arab in Yemen. The domain. So we cannot understand the Quran if we take it out of the context and claim, for example, as it is claimed, that it was an eternally registered in the, you know, wood reserve, etc., etc., lawh al-mahfuz, something like that. It's historical and it's linguistic structure. So we need historical linguistic approach. So this was, you know, one of the conclusions, that the Quran is a historical text. It's a cultural product. Okay. Of course, there is a very, very detailed analysis of the concept of wahi, revelation, what does it mean in pre-Islamic culture, etc., etc. The first receiver of the Quran, Muhammad, the situation in Arabia, the situation in Mecca. Okay. But being a historical text does not mean that its significance is limited to its historical context. Okay, that's because the Quran taken seriously by the believers were able to unfold, you know, the meaning of the Quran in so many, you know, cultural disciplines that reached, you know, philosophy, theology, literature, linguistics, rhetorical theory, etc., etc. But this was done by the social actor. Okay, and suppose, this is my argument, suppose that the Arab, the people of Mecca and Quraysh was able to destroy the nascent community, what would have been left in the Quran? Nothing, a manuscript that could be discovered later on and be taken and cleaned and studied and put in a museum. What made the Quran that we do have it, is the fact that, you know, generations and generations believed in it and tried their best to have their understanding of the text, existent in their life. So this is an argument. But this book did not really create, you know, a heavy reaction. It was surprising book, and celebrated by some people, not really appreciated by other people. Okay, but I was invited to so many, you know, even universities, not only my university, universities, to discuss this book. And sometimes questions, okay, such as, you apply human approach to the Quran, but the Quran is not a human text, it's a divine text. How can we accept a human approach to a human text, to a divine text? And my simple, immediate answer was like this. So you are suggesting that I should be divine to understand the Quran? And of course, the Quran is coming from divine source. But the divine have chosen a code of communication for humans to understand. So I'm sorry. It's only human understand the Quran. And sometimes this immediate answer, it was very immediate and very innocent answer. I didn't write it in my book, but it was addressed to me by a professor of philosophy. I was at that time, you know, a lecturer. So, and you know how this hierarchy in the academia, when, you know, a professor is talking to a lecturer. So the professor was like, you know, and I really immediately, in a very innocent way, answered this way. You are supposing that the only person to understand the Quran should have a divine, you know, features. So the people laughed in the auditorium. I didn't intend to, I mean, this really was not my intention to make the person, but this was my immediate, and I was later on surprised, because this is a very convincing argument. Okay, well, of course, I developed my concept later on. I mean, I have been working on this concept all my life. This has been the question of my life, that in the Quran, we can speak about, and here also my debt to hermeneutics and to modern linguistics, the communication theory, etc., etc.
The professor is objecting to this.
Yes. That, okay, the divine sent message, but the message is in the coding system of the recipient, not the divine. We don't know if the divine have any specific coding system or not. I mean, this is our own, you know, sphere of understanding, okay? But the fact that the divine have sent the human, okay, to reveal his message to the human. So the human code here is used. how God spoke to Muhammad. Wow, this is very, very complicated theory, and I dealt with it. Okay. I reached the conclusion that this kind of communication, whether we believe in the theory that it was through a mediator, the angel, Jibreel, we still have the same question. How did Jibreel communicate with Muhammad? Jibreel is an angel. Muhammad is a human. But at the end, the analysis of the concept of wahi, it revealed it's non-verbal communication. Whether God revealing his message to Jibreel, it's non-verbal communication. Or Jibreel revealing his message to Muhammad, it's non-verbal communication. But we have to take serious consideration to this aspect of the human dimension of the message. Okay. So far in the history of Islam, the divine dimension overshadowed the human dimension. Although pragmatically, the history of exegesis is dealing with the human linguistic approach, whether we speak about Tabari or Sayyid Qutb. Okay, so it's so the book was celebrated. Even those who was not really happy with the book did not really make any kind of violent reaction to the book. This book was part of my file to be an associate professor, and it was celebrated in the committee. As an excellent research at that time. This was 1987. I returned back. I spent 2 years in the United States when I was doing my research on Ibn Arabi, and here I learned about hermeneutics. I went to Japan as a visiting professor for 5 years, and here I learned something more about Buddhism, Shintoism. Okay. So I can tell, this really have enriched my vision of what Islam is, what Islamic culture should be. And then I returned back to Egypt. This was in the early 90s, and started, publishing other books and other papers. So everything was going smooth, until I applied for a full professor in 1992, and here all the problems came, and it is really not academic problems. It is more connected to political issues, connected to the fear of terrorism that terrorized the entire Egyptian society and the institutions, including the government. Okay, because after the assassination of Sadat, publicly, within his army, in his glorious day of October 6th. Okay. The terrorist discourse connected with a very, very radical Islamic discourse have been present everywhere, with all the government, arrest, it was there. There was another scandal in Egypt, a scandal that any Egyptian citizen could not ignore. At that time, the call for Islamism was everywhere. So at that time, there was tens of fatwas against the banking system. Interest in the bank, whether it is on loan or in deposit, is haram. This is riba. But within these fatwas, there was new emerging investment companies that claimed they are applying Islamic norms. No fixed interest rate, but sharing interest and sharing loss. But in the meantime, they started giving 25% interest. So by the fatwas, and by giving very, very high interest, that makes you, even if you are not an economist, wonder how those people can do. such, so, you know, is there any invest?
Because the Quran has prohibitions against interest.
Yes, yeah, but it's not against interest, it's against riba. Okay, but you know, but in modern Islamic discourse, they can easily make, you know, interest as riba and riba as interest, etc., etc. And this is the entire concept of Islamic banking system that exists everywhere in the world. In fact, a thorough study of all these Islamic banking, they are dealing with the same type of dealment of ordinary banks, but they give it another names. Okay. So it's for example, if you don't want to make a mortgage, okay, with an Islamic bank, they buy the house and sell you the house. But it is the same process. I mean, at the end of the day, it's the same process. Okay, the difference between the house, they make the buying the house and selling the house just on paper. Okay, but at the end, you are in mortgage, okay? But they tell you, no, you are not in mortgage, you are not paying interest, okay? Because this is, you know, commercial deal, and according to the Quran, it's halal. If I buy something of $10, okay, and then pay it for $1,000, that's halal. This is because this is buying and selling, so this is halal. Okay, it's a, but anyway, I mean, at that time, these investment companies, helped by these fatwas that came from the official religious institution, and it was shared on the TV advertisement with ministers. Okay, etc., 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 was able to deceive the entire Egyptian nation. The people, even some people, sold, if someone has a piece of land that it does not really give 25%, or someone is running, you know, a small shop, grocery shop, that doesn't, people just, if a lady have, you know, some gold, you know, stored for, you know, in the future, you know, how people, so everything people sold and put it in this company to get 25%. All the people who went to the Gulf that saved some money, oh, it's great. I wasn't in Japan at that time. And the Egyptian who were in Japan, the Egyptian PhD student was arguing with me, why don't you put your money in these companies? Because in Japan, Japan is an economic giant at that time. The interest in the bank is 3%. So my also immediate answer to those people, I'm not an economist, but I can understand if a company would give me 25% interest, it should have made 100% itself to pay the employee, to pay the office, to pay electricity, I mean. And this is only possible if you deal in narcotics. This is the only merchandise. So I suspect, you know, this one. But anyway, people have put all their money, and it turned very in 1 year that the people who established this company just escaped Egypt with the money. Until now. Now we are in 2009. This happened in the 80s. Until now, people are unable to get their money back. So this is not only a scandal, but a tragedy. That religion was used to deceive people. And it was possible because of the dominant ignorance about the meaning of religion. The government have played a role in this. The institution, the religious institution have played, it is not even the terrorist who made this. Okay. This was all the subject, I mean, these different dimensions were the subject of my book, Critique of Islamic Discourse, Naqd al-Khitab al-Din. And this is the book, the introduction of the book, in which I mentioned passing the scandal of the investment companies that inspired me that some critical analysis should be applied to this Islamic discourse. And I was very clear, Islamic discourse does not mean Islam. Islamic discourse is the human discourse about Islam, the human discourse about the Quran, the human discourse about tradition, the human discourse about Sunnah. It's very clear in my book that I am not touching the Quran or the Sunnah, but I'm trying to show how people are manipulating the meaning of the Quran. And this is very dangerous in the present situation. One of the three professors to evaluate was a counselor of one of these investment companies with a big month salary. Okay, you can understand that. Anyway, this person have written a very, very not negative academic report. It has nothing to do with academic report. It's just a report full of insult, accusation, kufr against Islam. This man is anti-Islam. He is like Salman Rushdie. Okay, all this kind of of nonsense. I didn't really pay attention because I thought that this is an academia, whatever he would write, because some people have advised me when we know that he is a member that I should, make some sort of no. To say no, I wouldn't like to him because he was a member of the. But I said, well, this will be only one vote. And this is an academia. So my trust in the academic integrity prevented me from disqualifying him to be in the committee. This was wrong. This is my mistake. I have a very strong confidence in the academic integrity, which was nothing. In the process, okay, of course the university did not go directly to take, well, first his report was taken by the committee, the wider committee, as the committee report. Of course, they have to delete some words like kufr, but they deleted it, and you can see it behind that. The university, the rector of the university, everyone, I was supposed to give my consent to say, okay, I agree.
You agree with this evaluation of you being?
Yeah, I agree that that you don't give me the title now, but in a couple of months I will reapply and you will get it. So this was a negotiation inside the university. Mm-hmm. I am who was supposed to be the victim, mm-hmm. was the person that everyone needed him to say, okay, let it go this time. Mm-hmm. This is starting from the rector of the university, the dean of the faculty, everyone. This is before the final decision was taken by the university. For me, and luckily for my wife is a professor in the same university in the French department, we said no, because it's the future of this academia. If we say yes, let it go this time, then we will be part of this corruption. I cannot go into the details of the meetings with the rector and the nonsense argument that the rector was trying to convince me to let it go this time. I said, well, we are in the academia. I mean, if you just endorse this report, if I say yes, and you endorse this report, how are you going to put on your CV? That you endorse it, a report which is a piece of garbage. I told the director at that time, I would make a report against my writing, but it would be academic. Report to reach the same conclusion that I am not entitled to professor. But I would write it in academic language, If this is academic language, I would have nothing. But it's garbage. How can you ask me to say okay for a garbage, and you are sitting there? I mean, it's an impolite way to speak to your rector of the university this way. But I did not give a damn about all these titles at that time, because at stake in my mind here is the academia that I had the dream to be part of it. And I'm not going to give up my dream. No one is going to enforce me to give up, to go with this corruption. And in the presence of other deans of other faculties, because this was like a meeting, I said, read the report and tell me what is academic in the report. The report does not go beyond page 19 in my book, Dr. Khattabidi. No citation after page 19. This is something, I mean, this is scandal. I mean, the man did not read the book. He was unable to read the book because he got insulted from the introduction. Anyway, this was a debate, and at the end, the university decided not to promote me. And the report came to the faculty. The faculty, the department protested. The department make a counter report. And the faculty protested and made a counter report. The final report has been to the university. Anyway, it has gone this way. And there was, you know, a lot of promises, something, just let it go this time and, you know, reapply. And it was, you know, something like that. This is connected to the situation in Egypt. Okay, the rector was so afraid if he promoted me that those people who are against me could provoke, you know, the student, you know, the Islamist student to make strike. You know, everyone was so afraid from the top to the bottom.
On how this book might spark reaction on the conservative Islamist movement?
Well, in fact, because I have been teaching Quranic study since 1970, 72, and in my class, I give more space to those who criticize my ideas than to those who accept it. Mm-hmm. Believing that the student who just accepts whatever I say is not a good student. Mm-hmm. Okay, so I appreciate more students who have this kind of... Well, at the beginning, the student was, you know, aggressive. But I was tolerant to this kind of aggressiveness until I teach the student the lesson to oppose ideas without being aggressive. So you can see that even the student whom, you know, I taught during this long time, who did not accept my ideas, have very deep respect to me. I was supported by the student, even the student who are supposed to be Islamist student. When the university took its decision, and it was well known that I was not promoted to full professor because of my views, not because of my academic failure. The Islamist student have made a wonderful statement. And I'm very proud of this statement, that although they don't agree with all of my ideas, but I am, according to their statement, an idealist professor. The real professor they have met. This is very, well, something that is, really satisfies me more than the title of being a professor. But anyway, I mean, so it has been known in Egypt, so the entire Egyptian intellectual life was decided between those who defend the academic freedom and those who defend, Islam. Okay, so it took, some months debate in the newspaper,
Before going on to the next part of the story, which is what happened when you when your case went before the Supreme Court.
Yeah.
I want to ask you a question about a recent trip that President Barack Obama took to the University of Cairo.
Yeah, yeah.
And he lauded the University of Cairo as a right. great academic institution.
Yes.
Right. And he used that as a point of departure for his new right. policy in the Middle East. Having gone through what you went through in Cairo, at the University of Cairo, what are your feelings about Barack Obama going there? And then speaking about it in the way that he spoke about it. What do you think about that?
This is my experience, which did not, really make me lose my confidence in the academia. For some times, okay, this was, a black spot, okay, in the academia. It is a black spot in the academia. But if you look to within the academia, the support I had and I have, you cannot really say that the entire academia is corrupted. Okay. Maybe people, when it comes to Quranic studies, are a little bit hesitant to speak out. Okay, but this is understandable.
Because of the potential threat of violence against them.
Yes, yes. In the celebration, Cairo University was established 1908. So last year was the centennial, 100 years. For the first time after I left Egypt, I was invited by my faculty of arts, to participate in a symposium, part of the celebration of the university. Of course, the dean now is my generation, even younger than me. And I just, I said, okay, he phoned me and they said, look, I appreciate this invitation, but I don't want to have it, oral invitation. Send me a written official invitation and pay the ticket for me. Okay, so I feel that you really, you understand that you're inviting someone. He sent me the written, official invitation. The university paid for the trip. And I was there. Of course, the opening ceremony of the conference was in the university, but the symposium itself was in a hotel. And no point can pass my mind. And that, I said, what is that? Celebrating the university by such a symposium in an hotel. Where are the students of the university? This is official government celebration. So I was very, very critical. And the dean came to me and said, you are right. But there are, higher orders. So I said, to put me away, not to give a lecture inside the university. Is that the meaning of it? He said, no, it is not intended for you. I said, but this is a test. But I was able, through another challenge, the Society of Philosophy, the Egyptian branch of it. They invite me every year, and they held their conference in the university. So I'm invited, I give lectures there. So in a way, I cannot really, I have support from this academia. When Obama and I was in Istanbul and I was at the airport and I was really keen to, it was shown on the TV, but it was in Turkish. So I opened my laptop and I listened to his speech. It's a wonderful speech. And I appreciate very much that he chose Cairo University, not Al-Azhar University. Because he had this choice, even go to Al-Azhar University or Cairo University. So his choice of it, he did not choose, the people who advised him. I think it was very good. And the way he spoke, not only about the university, but about, his speech in general. Okay. I really appreciated his speech, of course, with my personal awareness that we are demanding too much from a person. Okay, especially in the Middle East. The Middle East people does not understand that it is not the person in the United States system that decide everything. It's not like Egypt, where the president is everyone. Okay. This man has coming to a lot of challenges, internal challenge, inside, okay, and global challenge. Part of this global challenge is the Middle East. I wish him success, but I see it's too much. It's too much to ask. His speech was very good. I really positively appreciated, but some other Egyptian intellectuals, you know, did not really appreciate this positive. So they find something, as someone wrote about it, that he was trying to, you know, to present himself like a sheikh to the Egyptian people. And this has happened by Napoleon centuries ago, etc. But I cannot see in Obama, because Obama belonged, I mean, to a family, a Muslim. I mean, he is not claiming anything. Okay, the man is a great, great American citizen with a very, very rich background. Okay, and he just presented himself with his background. Okay, he did not claim that he is a Muslim, but you know, his father was. Okay, and when he was a child, he was exposed, you know, in Indonesia to the adhan, to all these things. So it's part of his, you know, of his consciousness. But you know, some Arab intellectuals have this kind of, you know, suspicious, you know, meaning. No, I really I am following all these kind of speeches that he gives here and there, and his struggle with the Israeli administration to stop settlement. And I understand the difficulty of this kind of dealing with the state of Israel. It's Obama maybe have, you know, a very good intention, but the relationship between the United States and Israel is more deep than to be a political relationship. It's deeper than being political. And how far the United States under Obama will be able to really play a neutral mediator role in establishing peace in the Middle East.
You actually, in your work, have talked about a Zionist Christian relationship that's actually prevented any dialogue in the Middle East. That kind of partnership that's coming.
Oh yes, yeah. First, I mean, this is the macro context of of the Muslim world and of the Arab world in specific. The invasion of the Muslim world by European power that, you know, dominated the Muslim world at the end of the 18th century, the entire 19th century, and part of the 20th century, have created two opposing factors. The positive factor is that, you know, the Arab and the Muslim world was awakened to its status, its regression. Okay, and I always take this as positive. I mean, you need a mirror to see yourself as a culture or as a person. Okay, without a mirror, okay, how can you see that there is some spots of ugliness in your appearance? So it's being confronted with the West in the late 18th century have you know, positively provoked the questions. Who are we? And what exactly happened? What we are Muslims, and you know, and Muslims in the 9th, 10th, 11th century who created this wonderful civilization and this wonderful culture all over the world. They belong to Islam and we belong to Islam. So what happened to us? This was a real positive question, to which there was the response of rethinking, reformation, okay? That the problem is in our misunderstanding, okay? That we have been kept away from the true understanding or the positive understanding. And so you can see this in Afghani and Muhammad Abdu, in India, from, you know, Shah Waliullah, Sayyid Ahmad Khan, in Yemen, Shawkani, and all those people that needed to rethink Islamic tradition, to return back, on, for example, in the field of fiqh or legal theory, to ijtihad again, to open up, you know, the gate of ijtihad again. For someone like Afghani is to return back to the philosophical concepts. I mean, Avicenna and Farabi. Okay, so this was a positive, but this positive response was encrypted with a fear, and this fear is with a fear of losing identity.
As a result. Colonialism and the
as a result of the domination of Western cultures and Western civilization. And if we add to this a certain challenge that was, you know, accompanied, you know, this military invasion, you can find the discourse of some politicians and some Orientalists at that time, which would explain the regression of the entire Muslim world in terms of religion, not in terms of social, economic, political, you know, situation. Well, I think you can find this in the discourse by French Foreign Minister Hanoutou, that one, what is keeping Muslims from being part of the modern world is that this kind of gap, huge gap between God and the human that does not exist in Christianity. Because Christ present, you know, this kind of, you know, human, divine, or other people. So you can see here that Europe, or the modernity in general, have been understood in this kind of ambiguous, perplexing way. It's the advanced, the rational, that we should imitate, okay? But it's the aggressive, the dominant, that we should resist. This really, you know, yeah, this kind of tension, again, you can find it in the discourse of the reformers. Okay, they could accept rationality, but if it is explained by the Mu'tazila or by Ibn Rushd, not the rationality of Kant, for example, okay, or Descartes, okay. All right, okay, so rationality, okay, but this, we need our own rationality, which is limited, okay. So making tradition as the source of what to accept and what not to accept gave tradition more powerful status, which was not intended by the reformers. They didn't intend that, but this is the way things work. If a discourse is under pressure of two conflicting powers, okay, then you can see in one way it is open, it is liberal, but in another way there is certain fear of this liberalism and openism. You have to resist, you know, being too liberal or being too rational. Okay, at the end of the day, you have to put wahy, revelation, as the way to control rationality. Okay, so this is but very, very easy. I mean, in my analysis of the situation, I can make a point here 1924. In 1924, this was the abolishment of Khilafat. Okay. Of course, this was, in my opinion, a natural development. I mean, after World War One, my analysis is the is like, you know, the declaration of the end of empires, and, you know, the birth of the national state. Okay, this is the meaning of World War One. Okay,
and that is what Ataturk intended.
Yeah, exactly. Okay. Well, so that the Turk wanted to establish their own nation-state was already established in Egypt and in Syria, but under the umbrella of the Ottoman Empire. Okay, but there were a lot of criticism to the Ottoman Empire in these societies in Syria, in Egypt, and in other places. When the Kemalist made a very wise decision, this was 6 months before the entire abolishment of Khilafat. They separated between Sultanate and Khilafat. Okay, so the Caliph is the Caliph of Muslims, but the Sultan is the Sultan of Turkey. This was celebrated in the Muslim world as, like, you know, to free the Caliphate from being connected to Turkey. But things, you know, went that they abolished Khilafat and they, you know, initiated a republic. This created a sense in the entire Muslim world, you can follow this in India, in the Middle East, everywhere, a sense of losing this kind of symbolic unity. It was symbolic. It has nothing, you know, practical at that time, but it was symbolic. But this was a symbolic unity of all Muslims. So it was something lost. So you can find in all these discourses about Khilafat, whether we should re-establish Khilafat, blah, 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 a sense of like someone who has been naked and he would like to cover. And the only thing to cover is Khilafat. Of course, there was an attempt to re-establish Khilafat, but the conflict between all the Muslim rulers, everyone wanted to be a caliph. So it was a great failure. Okay. So the question about identity have moved from re-establishing Khilafat to establishing a nation state ruled by Sharia. And this is still the ongoing debate. Of course, there are certain groups that still are hoping for establishing Khilafat, the Khilafat movement everywhere. But you can see here, I mean, this kind of development have changed the answer to the challenge of modernity. Okay, the answer to the challenge of modernity so far was rethinking, reformation. After this, it was returning to Islam. And there's a big difference between returning to Islam, which means the golden age are the model. So there's a big difference between the need to reform, to rethink, to reconcile tradition with modernity, and the claim to return, which means you are not Muslim anymore. So this is the takfir. Okay, which did not start as this, but it developed in this direction by Abu al-Ali al-Mawdudi. And don't forget, in this concept, we have two states established after World War II on religious basis, Israel, Pakistan. And you cannot really ignore the fact that this concept of establishing a state for certain religious group became a powerful weapon for the radicals in the Muslim world. We have to be aware of that. And since then, the complicated situation have made returning overshadow reforming. Reformation has been looked at now in a very suspicious way. as Westernization. Okay, as just applying Western values to the meaning of the Quran, blah 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 blah, etc. So this is the unfortunately the situation in which we live.
I wanted to ask you a question about the title of the Critique of Islamic Discourse, right? It suggests both to be Descartes, right, and Kant. Were you consciously thinking about Kant?
No, not consciously. I wouldn't say I was consciously.
Using like theoretical linguistics?
Yes, theoretical linguistics. Of course, I mean, my reading was, but this is my background, okay, about Kant, about Descartes, hermeneutics. But I did not really use any of these, concepts in my analysis. And you can find in my book, I don't really, make direct use of citations. In academic papers, I do that, but not in a book which is intended, to a more public audience, readership.
The next question, sets of questions I'd like to talk to you about, the specifics, what happened, like the chronology.
What happened after that, that some people, from different connection, some of them are university professors, some of them are lawyers, but they are all Islamists. They have, managed to go to the court, to present the case to the court. But of course, because in Egypt, in the Egyptian law, there is no such a crime like apostasy. So if there is no crime, there is no punishment. So they did, the people who make the case was very, very, intelligent. They did not ask the court to declare apostasy. But they asked, appeal to the court to nullify my marriage, because I am married to a Muslim woman, but my writing, according to certain opinion, have shown that I have been deviated from Islam, apostated from Islam, and according to Sharia, a non-Muslim could not marry a Muslim woman. So this was the way they formulated the case in order for the judge.
So you had deviated.
They didn't go on this charge. The charge was they are defending, God's rights, defending God's laws, which would not allow non-Muslim to marry a Muslim woman. Mm-hmm. And in my case, that's what they claim. My writing show that I have been deviated from Islam, so I should not continue my marriage with a Muslim woman. So they're asking the court something about marriage, which is under the authority of the court. Okay, but the basis of nullifying the marriage is based, this is how they formulated the case. In the first instant court, the entire case was rejected. Because there is no interest on the part of the plaintiffs. So the first instant court applied the norms of the civil court, the procedure of the civil court. On the civil court, the procedure, you cannot make a case unless you have an interest. If you don't have an interest, you are not entitled to make a case. So it was rejected on the basis of the procedure, the legal procedure, rather than in the content. Okay, and those people appealed, went to the appeal court. Okay, and the appeal court accepted the case and gave a verdict, nullifying the marriage on the ground that it's very obvious for the judge that my writing clearly indicate that I am an apostate. So the judge gave himself the power to give an opinion about, you know, about you know, debate, idea debate. This was a shock, not only for Egypt or for the Arab world, but for the entire world. Having, you know, Egypt as a very important, you know, country in the Middle East. So this was terrifying for everyone. Okay, even I think the president, I mean. So there was so many, you know, protest against this from all over the world. Not only human rights organizations, but academic institutions. Inside Egypt, of course, it was a shock. I mean, really, this made, you know, continuing, you know, living in Egypt, and I was immediately provided with a very heavy security measures. That actually, if you live under heavy security measure, your life is terrible. Okay. So this was in June 1995. For 1 month, life was really terrible. I mean, anyone coming to visit me, including, you know, my mother-in-law or my brothers and sisters, they have to be checked by the security people. I was like, you know, imprisoned in my house. Once I have to go to the university, this was a PhD thesis, defense under my supervision, and the security people tried to convince me not to go and to make someone else, you know, and I refused. This was the experience, you know, going from my home, which in outskirts of Cairo, 6 October city, to the university under heavy protection. I mean, cars with all these kind of. It's a paradox. It's like you are someone very important. Okay, because the president or the minister, the prime minister, there are always cars wheeling and motors. So I was like that. So I'm very Egyptian. So sometimes in a very, very dramatic position, I can make jokes. So I told my wife, I wish my mother was still alive. And my father was still alive. They was really, you know, I'm a very important person. But getting into the university under this, you know, procedure, security procedure, I considered the university my home. Mm-hmm. This was really too hard on me. Mm-hmm. I mean, just crossing into the university, because they established something like you have in at the airport. Mm-hmm. Okay, for everyone who would attend the defense, PhD defense and the ME defense, is public. Mm-hmm. But they have to choose the people who attend the events, and they have to check everyone. So they established this, you know, entrance, like at the airport. Of course, I didn't go through it, but everyone has to go through it. Yeah. When I saw this, it's no, this is not the university. I mean, in one moment, my wife and I just said, well, no, it won't work. At that moment, we decided, yeah, to go somewhere until something is done.
So could you have stayed? Could you have stayed? What do you mean by go somewhere?
Yeah, we discovered that it is impossible, okay, to live like this. And it would be very hard, because this was in summer, very hard if the academic year start to go to the university every time under the security measures. Mm-hmm. Okay. And to go into the class, which is the free, you know, encounter with your student. And I don't know if you know, in Egypt, I mean, we have, let's say, 500 students in the class. And so the students are sitting here and there. it's because there's not enough seats for the student. Mm-hmm. So in fact, you are, you know, how far this is going to work if you are surrounded by people with gun machines? How are you going to communicate with your student? I mean, this. So it's looking into this from this perspective. We said, okay, I have this invitation from Leiden University before the ordeal. Mm-hmm. Okay, as a visiting professor for a couple of years. Mm-hmm. Okay, so it was just at the beginning of the court case. So I responded. I said, I accept the invitation, but please give me time until this, you know, this court affair is clarified. And everyone was hoping that it would be clarified. I mean, this is nonsense. Mm-hmm. Okay, no one expected, you know, this end. So I immediately, you know, contacted the university through the Dutch embassy, and I said, well, I think the ambassador. I mean, everyone is following the news. Mm-hmm. The ambassador said, well, I think this is time that you accept the invitation of Leiden University. It has some space to breathe. Mm-hmm. Okay, and so I came to Leiden. I mean, with my wife. This was October 1995. Of course, there was always hope, and you know, that in the highest court, the cassation court, because my lawyers have decided to go to the highest court, things will return back to normal. The appeal verdict court will be nullified or something like that. But less than 1 year, in August 1996, the cassation court have withheld the ruling. I was here already. So the temporal, you know, trip. Turn it to be an exile, as some people would say. Mm-hmm.
Okay. Were you threatened? Did you have death threats in Egypt? Hmm? Did you have death threats in Egypt when you were under protection? Were you threatened?
Yeah, there was, of course, some letters, you know, unknown letters of threat. But this was not really something that I worried about. I mean, the support I just mentioned from my student would give me a very, very, very strong confidence that, well, of course, the chance is there. Any lieutenant can, you know, get, you know, a knife in your stomach or something like that. It's anywhere. Mm-hmm. But I could not imagine that there are certain group, I mean, organized group, that have interest in my case, because the person, the professor who made this allegation in his seemingly academic report, his reputation is not that good, even among Islamists. He's very well known as a corrupted person, and this is the irony. One very known corrupted person was able, in a very corrupted society, to do this. Mm-hmm. It's not his power. It's the power of corruption. Not inside the university, but all over the society. Mm-hmm. And this is all the time my point of strength, that everyone knows in Egypt that this person was corrupted. Mm-hmm. Everyone knows. From where did he get all this power? Unless we have a whole corrupted system. And unfortunately, this happened to be true. I mean, the following incident, the situation in Egypt, would tell everyone that corruption is the hero in Egypt. And the conflict between, you know what, it's not so much, we should not really pay a lot of attention to this kind of conflict between, you know, the Islamist and the secularist. It's serious. But the real problem in Egypt is corruption. And you can find corrupted people among the secularists and corrupted people among Islamists. So sometimes the question, where do you find uncorrupted person to be a friend with? with all, you know, the difference in opinions. Okay. And here, okay, my discourse from the very beginning was not against Islamism or against the Islamist, because the crackdown that the government do all the time against people, I say, well, those people have the right to express themselves in the political arena. I cannot really defend my right of free expression without defending the right of my opponent on free speech. We have to go out of this kind of, you know, of belonging, tribal belonging, that I defend my freedom and I defend the freedom of people who are just like me.
Very Voltairean.
Yeah. So from the very beginning, okay, I made it very clear, okay, on the ideological level, on ideas, okay, I have my differences with those people. But on their political right, I am a defender of their political right. I cannot accept a state which terrorizes people. Terrorism is not only coming from certain groups, but we have a police state, I mean, all over the Arab world, a terrorizing state, a state that claim religion, and Islam is the religion of the state. And when a state claim religion, it means that it claims certain interpretation of religion. And any interpretation which is not, you know, in accordance with the state interpretation, okay, is declared un-Islamic. So, and the meaning, the interpretation of the state is, you know, changing according to the changing political orientation of the state. If the state is socialist, so Islam is a socialist religion. When the state became, you know, adopted open door economic policy, blah, 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 open market, so then Islam is, you know, supportive of, you know, of this approach. We have to be very careful about that. Not really to support the state all the time. We have to be critical of the state, critical of the official religious institution, not to concentrate our criticism on these, you know, what we call Islamist groups or, you know, radical groups.
You have a very sympathetic view towards the Muslim Brotherhood, for example.
Well, not sympathetic. I mean, not sympathetic, I mean, in terms of ideology or ideas. I'm very critical of their play of words.
Okay.
When they, for example, generally speaking, they speak about equality. Okay. And when you go into the details of equality to ask, what about gender equality? They would, you know, hum about, you know, what Sharia, if you say, okay, all right, okay. What about equality between Muslims and non-Muslims? They would say the same old stuff. Well, they're all other brothers, but we cannot, you know, employ them in military actions because we might be in war against the Christian. I mean, they think in terms of the Middle Ages. Okay, so they have to pay extra things because they are not, you know. I'm very critical of that. But in the same time, I cannot endorse the state just arresting people because this, they have different. But the fact is that we have, I mean, intellectuals all over the Arab world to recognize that Islam is, whatever the manifestation of this concept in political life and in intellectual life, is part of the panorama of the Arab and the Muslim world since the 18th century. Since we have two solutions, you know, conflicting solutions. The solution that we should go into secularism, the solution that we should go into a theocratic state, the middle solution that we should establish a civil society, but, you know, but the ethics of Sharia should be, so these are the reality, okay? We need, I mean, all of us, we need a free market of debate, rather than people in the prison, when people are in prison because of political reasons, the majority of people sympathize for those who are in prison. Mm-hmm. And with this sympathy, they just swallow their ideas as right, because it's against the government. Mm-hmm. So we have to analyze, I mean, all this kind of direction, okay? And therefore, I'm sympathy, yes, with their political freedom. Everyone political freedom, mm-hmm. okay? Everyone political freedom. But with their ideology, no. Okay, I sympathize with Hezbollah or with Hamas in the way they resist occupation. Okay, but in any aggressive action or in any religious manipulation, no, I cannot sympathize with that. So it's not really support for ideology. It's support for something practical. Okay. Freedom, we all need freedom. And we should go out of the hook to defend the freedom of ourselves and our, you know, people who with us, and just to keep silent about, you know, the violation of freedom of other people who are not like us. This is something I learned also from the studying the history of Islam. The history of how the state, since the Abbasid Caliph, tried to manipulate religious idea in order to strengthen the authority of the state. Because the great Abbasid Caliph Ma'mun wanted to make the doctrine of the created Quran as the official state. He wanted to enforce everyone to adhere to this doctrine. So he established an inquisition. Okay. Later on, another caliph who have some other different opinion about this doctrine have to support the opposite doctrine. And we need to learn the state should be neutral in terms of religion. Religion, it has to be debated, discussed among the communities. The debate has to be there to watch that no one violate the right of another one. This is what I understand the state. The state claiming religion is a dangerous state than Islamism. The difference here between Islamism and the state that claim religion is not a difference of quality, is a difference of degree. The state claim Islam, and these groups claim another Islam. And the victims are Muslims and non-Muslims.
Before I come back to those questions of exile, I'd like to ask you a couple questions with regard to Egypt and also how Egypt fits into the patterns that are developing in the Middle East at the same time and North Africa. During the period when you were beginning to experience difficulties, there was the assassination attempt on Mahfouz.
Oh yes, 1993, I think. Right. Yeah.
So roughly the same.
And Mubarak.
Mubarak. Right.
In Ethiopia.
Mm-hmm. Do you remember when Mahfouz, the Nobel laureate, was attacked, and what your thoughts were about that particular?
Well, Mahfouz was, of course. I mean, we know the history of the attack on his novel about Aulad Haritna, the novel which was mentioned among the works to be granted Nobel Prize. But it was 1993. I was still in Egypt when Mahfouz was attacked by someone, an illiterate young man, who just heard in the mosque, who have no idea that this man is a kafir. And before Mahfouz, this was the assassination of Farage Fulton. Right. Yeah. And then when Mubarak was in Ethiopia, there was another attempt. Whether it is planned by Muslim Brothers in Sudan or not, this is another question. But since the assassination of Sadat in 82, assassinations and killing and, you know, terrorism was very, very active in South Egypt. Mm-hmm. But because it was so far away from Cairo, mm-hmm. okay, and South Egypt, as we know, or the government discovered, mm-hmm. was extremely underdeveloped, mm-hmm. I mean, compared to North Egypt.
You're speaking about the tourist attacks?
No, before the tourist attack. The tourist attack was 1998. Mm-hmm. I was here. No, I mean, immediately after the assassination of Sadat in 1982, the Upper Egypt was under the control of, you know, of those groups, the jihadists. Okay, and they were, you know, terrorizing the everyone. But because it was so far away from Cairo, from the political intellectuals and, you know, the culture, whatever it is. Mm-hmm. So it was like, you know, a news coming from another country. And then it reached Cairo. And this was, I think, 1990. Mm-hmm. It reached Cairo when the parliament spokesman was assassinated at 1 o'clock noon in front of one of the five-star hotels in Cairo. Here, the entire, you know, the entire official society became very aware of the danger of terrorism. Mm. And there was certain bombing in downtown Cairo. Mm. Okay. And there was an attack on some ministers. Of course, they didn't kill them, but they were hurt. Mm. Okay. So here now, I mean, there was, you know, a campaign. They called it at that time anti-terrorism campaign. Mm. All the intellectuals of Egypt, you know, but the campaign was intended to support the government, mm. not really to be anti-terrorism, mm. whatever terrorism coming from. So this also, again, terrorism have enabled the state to manipulate intellectuals. Intellectuals who became afraid of terrorism, but they lost insight to what does it mean, terrorism. It's like the war against terrorism in the world now. It's, you know, it's one eye looking to terrorism. At that time, I was invited as an intellectual to be part of this campaign of no terrorism. Well, of course, I am against terrorism. But I did not find anyone from the Islamic intellectuals invited in this campaign. And when I asked, why did you invite such and such person? They are against terrorism. Of course, they are Islamists, but they are not terrorist Islamists. So everyone was looking at me as I'm insane. I said, if you would like to have a collision of Egyptian intellectuals against terrorism, you should not exclude any intellectual. You should not classify intellectuals. You invite everyone, and who would not come, then he is identifying himself. This was something, I mean, that maybe that put me in a very, very few intellectuals that are very critical of this kind. When it came to Mahfouz, and of course, I mean, of course, all intellectuals. I mean, Mahfouz after war is a novelist, and for every Egyptian intellectual, he is like our godfather. Really, I mean, no intellectual living in Egypt now can say I did not learn from Mahfouz. Even, you know, the very Islamist intellectuals. Okay, so he is, you know, like, you know, a national icon. So this was, you know, to the heart of everyone. Okay, before that it was the assassination of Farish Fouda. Okay, and then came my case. So it's a series of conflict, and I should tell you Najib Mahfouz joke about the university depriving me of being a full professor. When he learned about this, Najib Mahfouz is a very Egyptian with this kind of humor sense. When he learned about this, he said, well, the Cairo University does not have any objection having an associate professor who is apostate, but they object to have a full professor apostate. This was the man. I mean, because I was there. I was, you know, getting associate professor for the same ideas. I mean, so here is the joke of Najib Mahfouz. So this was a series of, you know, of going down. Okay. And my case, well, clearly indicate that the entire state, all the institutions, including the academic institution, were victims of this kind of terrorism. Victims to the extent they give away any kind of academic integrity or something like that. And I'm afraid to say, 1995, the Egyptian society, the intellectual group, was able to stand against that. It is not possible now. There are so many cases. It did not reach the court. But so many cases of depriving a brilliant scholar from promotion while promoting, you know, every day. No one. But yeah, this is the priorities became more into, you know, corruption, into
another case that some people have talked about in relation to yours is Salman Rushdie.
Yeah.
How do you feel about that comparison to Salman Rushdie?
Well, I didn't really make, I mean, in this report, he made this connection between me and Salman Rushdie. Because
you mean your adversary?
Well, in one of my comparison between, you know, religious discourse in the Muslim world and religious discourse in the Western world, I mentioned, you know, how just a novel like Satanic Verses have provoked this kind of, you know, demonstrations, even violent demonstrations, by people in the Muslim world who never read the novel.
Mm-hmm. Including the Ayatollah Khomeini.
Yes, I mean, it's, and while at that time there was, this is, you know, I think, The Last Temptation of Christ. Mm-hmm. Okay. Mm-hmm. Which is a wonderful movie. That, of course, I mean, the church was really, you know, wanted to stop this. There was certain attempt to, you know, to fire in Paris, some movie houses in Paris, something. But there was no certain statement from the Pope against the film. Well, people are angry. Okay, right. So this was, you know, the comparison I made. I mean, how the religious discourse in the Muslim world are so, you know, fragile, that a novel would present threat to an entire civilization called the Islamic civilization. Of course, we know that it was Khomeini in the last chapter of the book. Okay, conveyed in the last chapter the imam from behind the veil, dark room, okay, etc., etc., etc. So he in his you know attack against me, he said he is even defending, you know, this hallucination of Salman Rushdie. Okay, my opinion about the entire thing about literature, whether it is Salman Rushdie or Najib Mahfouz or literature is literature. It should be approached from literary critical approach. Okay, if we think, and I wrote about this in Arabic, if we think that in a novel every statement is the author's statement, this is absolute stupidity, because we don't understand what is narrativity is. Okay, a novel is a polyphonic structure of literature. Okay, art has its specific way of signifying. That just taking art as a statement is stupid. Whether this art is a painting, is a song, is a poem, is a novel. And my point here is, how come that Muslims who have a text which is the Quran, which is an excellent narrative text, became so stupid to reject narrativity. Okay, you don't read the Quran. Sometimes in my public lecture in Arabic, you don't read the Quran. The Quran is music. You have to learn how to tajweed, and this is music. So how dare you say music is haram? If you need to know some music in order to be able to recite the Quran in a proper way. So how can you speak about the Quranic narrative? Okay, and to say this is haram and this is halal. Okay, if we apply this kind of stupid criticism to the chapter of Joseph in the Quran, in which the scene of the Pharaoh's wife seducing Joseph is really a scene in the Quran. Of course, it is expressed in a highly literary language, but it is there. She was about to have him, he was about to have her, but the divine interfered. So it's, I mean, from very early, I was in Japan when this scandal of Salman was there.
And they killed his Japanese translator.
Yeah. So this is my, you know, my view. It's why should we feel danger from anything, whatever? Okay, I mean, within this cartoon. Thing and you say, oh my God, this is, I mean, all those people don't know, thousands of books are written against Muhammad. Thousands of books are written against Jesus. Okay? All these thousand books did not destroy the faith. I mean, it's the demand is always how to advise Muslims to respond in a civil, rational way to any kind of challenge. I said we should change, Muslims should take this as a challenge, not as a threat. In case of threat, you immediately, you know, make retaliation. But in case of a challenge, you have to think about what is said. Criticism of religion, criticism of religious figure, is something that is very important to the development of religious idea themselves. And the history of every religion is the history of, not the history of apostasy, it's the history of, you know, going beyond challenging the dogma, okay? And only when the dogma is a challenge, only after being challenged, it is able to reconstruct itself. Otherwise, it would be frozen. Okay, so this is the history of the development of all religions.
And you, in your writing, you're very much against the frozen nature of his chronic interpretation.
Right.
The frozenness.
Right.
I'd like to ask you just a couple more questions about you may have heard of or thought about your case in relation to the Algerian writer Taharao Djaout. Do you remember? He was killed in 1993. It's Djaout. Taharao Djaout. He was one of the kind of leading critics of the Islamist in Algeria, but also the
Algerian. Oh, Algeria, yeah.
Algeria. And the Algeria kind of came to symbolize the great challenge for protecting the right of critique. A lot of ways, a lot of people from Algeria ended up in exile in the West, right? And it became one of the principal, because there was, you know, political Islam developed there in a particular way, and there was a possibility for the Islamists to come to power, the state canceled the elections, and then for the next decade, there was a pretty violent
war. I know.
Did you ever think about your case as it was unfolding in relation to these other national situations, national tragedies, such as Algeria?
Well, there is a connection. I mean, if you look into the intellectual aspect of this, not into the special, personal, or political aspect of it, there is a connection. Mm-hmm. And very early in this 1990, when the election was cancelled mm-hmm. by the state, on the ground, the fear of those people when they came to power, they abolished democracy. Mm-hmm. Okay, this was 1990, and I was just still. There was no attack on my ideas at that time. Mm-hmm. But this was really something that provoked my criticism. And I still, that if we agree to take democracy as our political solution, we should take whatever result democracy would lead. Mm-hmm. We should take the adventure. Mm-hmm. Okay. And at that time, I said, any political power, not only the Islamist, mm-hmm. let's say the socialist or the communist or whatever, I mean, we are still unable to completely accept diversity of opinion. So if any, I expected any political group to reach through democracy, the position of ruling will demolish democracy. It's not only the Islamist. It's a mentality that is not yet completely able to take this concept of pluralism. At that time, I was very critical of the Algerian state, and critical of the European state who supported the decision mm-hmm. of the Algerian state. Let the Islamists rule. Let them fail. Mm-hmm. Give the people the chance to see the failure of this ideology. If you all the time suppress it, you will never get the people understanding that this is very dangerous. This is the same that happened with Hamas. Mm-hmm. Hamas gained the election, mm-hmm. not because people have free choice, because people have to choose between corruption and utopian Islam. Mm-hmm. They did. Okay? Europe did not give the Palestinian people the chance to see the failure of Hamas. Mm-hmm. They seized Hamas. And in fact, they harmed the Palestinian people in order to get Hamas collapsed. This is the wrong politics. Mm-hmm. Okay, as I said, in 1990, let the people taste the fruit of Islamism. This is the forbidden fruit, mm-hmm. like Adam in paradise. Mm-hmm. Okay, you need to taste this forbidden fruit to get free. If just everything will be just under the control, whether it is the control of the internal power, of the international power, there is no solution for the Muslim world. Iran is about to get out of the hook. It's very difficult. Okay. Also for the interference of the European, of the Western power. Mohammad Khatami was there. Okay, the reformist was there. Iran under Mohammad Khatami was on the axis of evil, according to Mr. Bush, that gave again power to the conservative against the reformist. The international politics is a mess in terms of its impact on the Islamic world. Iran is about to go out of the hook. Why? Because they already tasted this forbidden fruit. No one in Iran now, even but between the conservative, the liberal conservative, would say we need a theocratic state. The Wilayat al-Faqih theory is challenging inside the Hawza itself. I mean, inside the traditional religious institution. Okay, this is the only way. And let, you know, the international politics, okay, leave space for the internal dynamic to work on. Interference would really, you know, crypt the internal dynamic from developing into the right direction. So what happened in Iran lately, okay, it was very good. I mean, Obama was very wise, really, not to make any statement that could be taken as, you know, interference in the body. But he was under the pressure to make this statement. Okay. Yeah, you can support the people. You can speak about the freedom of people to make demonstration, etc., etc., etc. Let the Muslim world go through the dynamic that Europe went through long time ago. Okay, Europe was able to succeed because there was no external power to intervene all the time and to create this kind of, you know, crippling the development.
Well, you just said reminds me of something that Mandela said, and actually in your book there's a reference to Mandela, Nelson Mandela.
Yes.
When you accepted the freedom of religion, there's a direct reference to Nelson Mandela.
Yeah.
What do you think that the world learned from Mandela's approach to power? Because you make a direct.
Yeah. Well, I think in the context of you know. Claiming, as it was also Bush all the time, claiming by Bush after 11 September, immediately after 11 September, and then this claim was repeated in, you know, all the political leaders in Europe, that putting Islam in opposition to our values and the expression our values of freedom, our values of equality, our values, blah, 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 blah. And when it is put like this, our values, it means excluding non-Western cultures, non-Western nations from being part of these values. So when you claim the values, I mean the modern values, my argument here was this is not your values. This is the values that the human race reached from the very beginning of the history until now. It is expressed now in this geographical area called the West. Because this is, again, the process of how civilization developed and changed from region to region. But with this kind of moving, it carries with it all the positive dimension, all the positive values that have been accumulated through human experience. So if we speak about human rights as absolutely Western production, then the West here is claiming that the entire history of human being has nothing to do with that. While we should take, you know, knowledge of Spartacus, this, you know, people who are killed to be free of slavery. So from Spartacus to Nelson Mandela, you cannot just, you know, delete this history and you say, we, our values. Not to mention, okay, the Islamic values that have traveled all the way through Sicily and through Spain, okay. This, how can we, you know, invest this knowledge in the mind of those stupid politicians all over the world? And if a wise political discourse is produced, then this will minimize all this kind of tension, conflict when you say our values and a Muslim sheikh or a Muslim say, wow, yeah, but this value is against Sharia. Okay. But if you present these values, and this is the value of the history of human endeavor, including, you know, certain aspects of Islamic civilization, the fact that, you know, that Aristotle, okay, the Arabs have, you know, made a lot of commentary about Aristotle. And through the Arabs, that Aristotle became known in the Middle Ages in Europe before they discovered the manuscripts of Aristotle. These are, you know, this should be, you know, common knowledge to be taught to in the schools all over the world. If we really look to globalization as a blessing, but in the dominant international religious discourse, globalization is a mean of domination, and here it creates all the fear, all identity problems, all over the world, not only on the Muslim world, but in different parts of the world which are non-Muslims. How can you know a discourse, a political discourse, and here is Obama. Okay, I think that's what distinguish Obama, this kind of awareness. And to tell you the truth, every day I was waiting when Obama will be killed. Because this is the history of America. Or when he will be fully manipulated within the system. So you have a man of insight, the American people have make a very good choice, but the world around is not. So here I mentioned Nelson Mandela, and here also you can understand my defense of the liberty and the freedom of the Islamist.
Okay.
I cannot accept democracy under the condition I should be the one to be elected. Mm-hmm. This is not democracy. Of course, democracy as it is practiced in the Arab and the Muslim world is not the real needed democracy, because democracy basically is a conclusion of individual freedom. One vote, one person. This is democracy. Okay? But democracy in the Arab and the Muslim is a procedure. It's not really based on this kind of concept of freedom. Freedom of individual to take his or her decision was established before democracy became a political system. Mm-hmm. The Arab world and the Muslim world is jumping, you know, through women are not really dealt with equally. Even human, I mean, the family is the strong. I mean, you can, in the majority of the Arab world, even the male cannot make decision about his marriage. It is the family decision. Not to mention the female. In such a society which is more or less living under tribal code, we need, in order to have a real democracy, to go into this kind of freedom, to instill the concept of freedom. Of course, the concept of freedom will conflict with the Sharia, so many Sharia concepts. The concept of man, of the human in Sharia, is a very limited concept. It's not the human, it's the duty-bounded human, not the right-bounded human. Okay, the mukallaf, as the fuqaha would say. So there is a lot of research to be done. Amendment. Democracy in Egypt. We have parties, yeah, right? But what? We cannot say it is the democratic system in which every person, every individual has one opinion of him. Opinions can be formulated by the media, can be formulated by even, buying votes, by money.
I want to turn to some questions about your life here right now. So you've been living in exile for almost a decade.
15 years.
15 years, over a decade. In the Netherlands, and in your book, you talk about the ebb and flow, if you will, of exile, and the kind of personal problems that can result from it. And you're quite honest about depression and not feeling at ease sometimes in Europe. But can you talk, just as a matter of definition, what does exile mean to you? What is Egypt itself is one of these countries where often the
well, I'm, well, in fact, it's. I mean, I did not feel. An exile. I mean, I don't even like the word exile. Maybe it's I'm migrant.
What?
Immigrant. But not exiled. Because there is no exile in the modern world. Exile in the modern world, in the classical sense, it's to be so far away from the reality that you have been rejected, in which you have been rejected. No one is so far from any reality now. Okay. I read the Egyptian newspaper on the internet. I communicate with my friends in Egypt by the emails. Not to say the phone. Okay. I send my articles to be published in Egyptian newspapers, in Egyptian magazines, and in Arab magazines. Okay. So I didn't really, you know, it's we have to rethink the concept of exile in the modern world. Being in Amsterdam, being in Leiden here, all the people who travel to the United States or somewhere, okay, friends, I was able to see my Egyptian friends more here than I used to see them in Cairo. Okay. Everyone made a stop in Amsterdam for one night. Okay. Yeah, because in Cairo sometimes you need, you know, one day to reach someplace because of the traffic problem, you know. So it's not really, you know, exile. It's in the first 8 years I was so angry from what happened. So deeply angry. Not angry from someone. Angry from Egypt. Mm. It's, you know, it's a kind of anger that you are angry from your mother. Mm. Okay, you feel your mother, whom you have a very good will to do everything good for her. And this was, I'm teaching your children. Mm. I'm trying to be a good teacher. I never, you know, allowed myself to any kind of slight corruption, like selling my books, for example, in the course. I was insisting on, you know, a list of resources that students should consult. So I did my best to teach your children in the best way I can in the context of Egypt. This was, you know, deeply my feeling, this kind of anger, okay, that separated my life to day life and night life. Day life, Egypt is not in my mind at all. I am very busy with my student here, I mean, with my colleagues, never think about Egypt. Nightmares, dreams. I see the faces of my student. I don't know the names. The faces of my student. My anger from Egypt that really I wanted to do something. I wanted to establish a school of Quranic studies. Okay, so this is what I call my small garden that has been so this is my loss. It's not losing to be in Egypt or losing because Egypt is not a geographical space for me. Okay. No, Egypt is something bigger than that. This was when on the plane coming, I talked to my wife and said, well, We don't know how long we will be out of Egypt, but please, if I die anywhere, don't take my body back to Egypt. I have in this time a terrible experience I had with an Egyptian who died in the United States, and I was the one who was responsible with this procedure. Okay. This was my Egyptian friend, and I was there in Philadelphia at that time. So I know how the difficulties, even dealing with the embassy to have a permission. It's terrible. I have in my mind this terrible. I don't want my wife to go through all this. And I told her, all the soil of the world is the soil of God. So I mean, I think I in one of the interviews I said something like that, and so I had to answer this question from an Egyptian. I don't think in America. I think, did you say this? I said yes. I think I did, and the Egyptian person was very angry. He said, "Well, I think the Egyptian people are very angry because you said that." I said, "Really? I didn't know that." But maybe because the Egyptian think about Egypt as a graveyard, not as a place to live. For me, Egypt is a place to live, not to be buried in. And the person came to me after that to say, for the first time I realized that. I said, yes, I mean, Egypt is something bigger than to be a graveyard. You ask to be buried in its soil after death. We need to have Egypt as a place, a safe place to live. This kept me, I mean, this kind of anger, you know, kept me for 8 years from making any trip to Egypt. But suddenly, I mean, and it happened like intuition. What kind of stupidity is this? Now you are giving Egypt to other people. Now you are denying that Egypt is not a monolithic entity. You have people who support you, you have your friends, you have your family. So if you hate part of Egypt or angry from part of Egypt, you should not be angry. So I decided to celebrate my 60th birthday with my family. It was celebrated on a national level. And this started to heal, you know, the wounds, you know, gradually. I am immigrant, yes, maybe. Okay, but in exile, this is very hard to say. I was invited later on to different Arabic countries like Syria, like Jordan, Tunisia, Morocco, Lebanon several times. So I can see there are some people who hate me, but there are a lot of people who really celebrate my ideas. So this gave me don't make any kind of of generalization. But as an intellectual, as a thinker, you should expect some people to refuse your ideas. Mm-hmm. I mean, this is very normal. I mean, in life, so don't get angry when people are not happy with your idea. Get angry if they try to kill you for that. Mm-hmm. And here is my defense. Okay, even this professor, who is the cause behind all this, what happened? He wrote a book. And he was extremely attacked, accused of apostasy, and people were trying to take him to the court to repeat the same thing. And I was phoned by a journalist from Cairo, and the man, the poor man, thought that I will feel happy about that. And he was disappointed because I felt terrible. I said, this is like setting fire in our country. If people kill everyone because he write a book they don't like, what will be left? And the man said, so you are against that? I said, absolutely I am against that. It doesn't matter if it is happening to one who is stupid, but I cannot be stupid like him to support this kind of nonsense. And the Egyptian Organization of Human Rights was holding a seminar, and they contacted me if I can send them my statement. So I did. I did send a statement. Support for freedom of expression Okay, and I made it very clear, okay, it's not that I'm supporting the book. Okay, I didn't say my opinion about the book, because it's a really very stupid book. Okay, but being stupid does not justify to kill the person. Otherwise, we will kill, 70% of the humanity. Okay. This made him more crazy, against me. The paradox that I'm defending his right, okay, it's like I have driven him more crazy against him, because everyone was asking him, you see, what is the difference between you and Abu Zayd? Okay. But this is not, it was not to have a point against him. This is my position. Okay. No, everyone is entitled to write a book. Everyone else is entitled to say no and to respond to this book by writing another book. But not making this kind of crazy reaction, okay, intimidation of the people, because they are, maybe I don't like this song, I don't like this painting, I don't like, this, but I should judge this on the basis of what does it say to me. Not on the basis that it is against Allah or against God or against us. Who knows? My relationship now with my country is a very good relationship. A friend of mine asked me, I feel that your suffering is. I said, no hard feeling now. Okay. I made this reconciliation with myself, okay, because it was in myself, not really in something. I have my family. I am the chief of the family. I have a tribe over there, and I'm the oldest one of the tribe. Okay, so when I go there, I really enjoy this kind of a tribe chief. I really enjoy it. Life. I'm invited to give lectures, to participate in this, Society of Philosophy. Of course, I meet people who are, but I'm able to respond in a very, very proper way, and most of the time, effective way. Okay, because after all, I'm a teacher, and this is something very good. If you are a teacher and you have all this kind of possibility to respond to your student, okay, so you develop a way of making argument against your opponent that really kick him down. Okay, so now it's in Europe, there is an Islamist in Europe, all over. All the Islamists that were protected under the principle of human rights because they were persecuted in their country, they are here, and they are against my ideas. In Germany, in the Netherlands, everywhere I go. Sometimes they come as a campaign to attend my lecture, especially if it is in Arabic. Okay? But it's very easy that, I start talking about, Quranic studies, etc., etc., and take them into something that they never heard of. They leave after 5 minutes. So I became like an expert, because I know exactly what is in their mind. They don't have, they got their knowledge from second, third, third hand books or fourth hand books or from oral communication. So if you took them to the deep level of the classical discussion about the Quran, they will feel lost. Okay. And that's my demand in the Muslim world, that we should have certain efficient educational system. People are, attracted to this kind of fundamentalism by ignorance and by hating the society in which they live. So it's injustice in a way, especially with the economic globalization. With the economic free market accepted in the entire world, without the essential and associating concept of freedom. Okay. Freedom was established first, and then the free market was built. In the Arab world, it's, or the Islamic world, it's the opposite. So people are suffering from the free market; they are not enjoying the free expression.
You mentioned the Islamist response to your work here. How have the Dutch responded to your work and your lecture?
I have to confine my response to the question to the academia, the academic. I think part of the of my academic colleagues, will consider my work as a genuine academic work, okay, critical approach, and they would appreciate very much the fact that I am not by any means working outside the paradigm of Islam. Okay, I'm a critical scholar, but from within the paradigm of Islam. Maybe my critical approach is also applied to tradition in general. So I'm not working within the paradigm of tradition, but within the paradigm of Islam, which is to say the Islamic worldview. General, and they appreciate that. When I came here with these circumstances, some people expected me to benefit from this, being victim, to present myself as a victim, And you know how it is, if you present yourself as a victim of Islam, in any Western society. You have been protected, you have been... But no, from the first moment, I refused that. I'm not a victim of Islam. If you receive me as a victim of Islam, you are wrong. I'm a victim of political problems that could have happened in any place in the world, and it happened in Egypt, and it is a coincidence that I was there. So it could have happened to someone else. The society needed someone to be a victim, in order for the society to fight, a struggle. When I was, presented here, when I arrived here of political asylum, I refused. After the cassation court verdict, again, the Dutch authority have approached me and asked me if I would like to have a passport. I said no. I would like to keep my Egyptian passport. I still have been my Egyptian passport. Because I'm not a political asylum. I would like to keep my position as a visiting professor. Okay. This is something that has to do with me. It has nothing to do with the situation outside me. So some of my colleagues appreciated very much that I did not invest my position as a victim in a public, presenting myself, as the victim person. Some of my colleagues expected, as long as I am refused in Egypt, then I should be, a dissident. I mean, my ideas should be very, very deviated from Islamic norms. So those were shocked when I gave my inaugural lecture about the chair in Leiden. I was very critical, for example, of Israel in this speech. This was the second intifada. Children were just killed. I mean, this. And you know how, if you are critical of Israel, anti-Semitism, this kind of. And I presented the Quran, this was my lecture here, the Quran as divine human communication. God and man communication. So some people said, this man is a Muslim, he's a good Muslim. They don't like that. They don't like that. And some even came to me after the, what brought you here? I said, because some stupid people think that I'm not a Muslim. That's what brought me here. He said, but you are a Muslim. I said, yes, I'm a Muslim. Not I'm as a stupid Muslim as other stupid Muslims, but I'm a Muslim. I mean, being a Muslim here is something beyond religious affiliation. You belong to this culture. Okay. I felt really humiliated when Mr. Bush said, our culture. I felt humiliated. And I'm not a terrorist. Okay, this is, you belong to a domain of culture. Okay. Of course, you are open. Okay. But you still have certain belonging. So now, they turn it out now that, you know, those moderate professors, well, they really, I mean, I enjoy a very good reputation in the Dutch academia, in specific, and in the European academia in general. With the exception of those people who turned after September 11, who were professors of Islamic studies, but turned extremely to produce anti-Islam discourse. So now they are my enemy. I mean, they attack me on the Dutch newspaper. Okay. But sometimes, okay, this attack even does not deserve to respond to. Generally speaking, okay, I'm not quite sure about the Muslim communities, but only the Ahmadiyya community invited me to give some lectures, and I was very critical of the Ahmadiyya, but they are very tolerant, I mean, they are very open. Other Muslim communities, I know persons, I know individuals, but I don't have any connection with the group.
Mm-hmm. One last question. You mentioned September 11th and watching the events of September 11th and being quite saddened by the events of September. How do you think September 11th changed the world within the Muslim context, but also your approach to how you will talk about Islam?
Well, it didn't affect my approach really. Mm-hmm. I mean, because I know about terrorism that started in Egypt. I know its development. I know how it became a global phenomenon. Mm-hmm. Okay, I mean, everyone knows about that. And how this became globalized by the helpful of this struggle between the United States and the Soviet Union, etc., etc., etc. So we know how it is. It did not really change my basic approach. It changed my discourse. So I have been more critical to political Europe, political West in general. And because the media, the Western media, after 11 September was either you have to be anti-Islam, or they could tolerate your criticism to Islamic culture, but they were able to tolerate any criticism to the Western discourse. Not only from me, but from some Dutch professors. You have to be one way. Okay. And because as a scholar, I refuse to be one way. Okay, this is so for some time I was not really, invited in interviews or something like this. I think the situation changed now a little bit. Yeah, so there's certain change, especially after the powerful domination of the rightist anti-Islam discourse, especially in the Netherlands, that the Dutch people started to realize that this is very dangerous discourse, very dangerous for the Netherlands.
And also, for example, Tehran,
yeah,
the assassination.
Yes, yes. I live in an absolutely Dutch neighborhood. Mm-hmm. Okay. And I'm contacted, although I don't speak Dutch, I failed to learn the language because I'm traveling a lot, other reasons. But I communicate with my neighbors, they are willing to communicate with me in English, and they know about my books, because some books have been translated into Dutch now, and I can feel the change. hopefully it will be a genuine change of of tolerance or respect.